Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine all the people living life in peace. Imagine all the people sharing all the world. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us. World will live as one. I trust you are a dreaming people. When John Lennon and Yoko Ono brought that to us, I don't think they understood how many people that would inspire. How it would reach around the world. Jimmy and Rosalind Carter, when they traveled, they reported that in 125 countries, they discovered people singing that song or playing that song. It was used at the beginning of the recent Olympics in South Korea. Over 200 artists have performed it. It's a very popular piece. Imagination, dreams, visions. I'm getting a lot of feedback or whatever. Is it a little too loud, maybe? Is that better?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Rob. Imagination, dreams, visions. That's when we have those things that don't seem to come from really our conscious mind. They are when we form or have things formed in our minds that they don't seem to know where they come from. They seem to come from beyond us. There's really no foundation in reality that causes them. I would call them our soul force, or the force of our souls reaching out and trying to make clear the possibilities that are out there. You know, that whole thing about imagination and dreams and visions, we can see them differ from each other, but they also share something in common. As all this history is, there are evidences that people had dreams, visions, they had a wild imagination. That's what's inspired all the things on the walls of caves, and how people developed music, and how people developed art, and how people told stories. It's imagination. The Roman Empire saw it so important that if someone prominent had a big dream, they were invited to come to the Senate and share that dream with everybody in the Senate. Was that important? It said that Abraham Lincoln had a vision of seeing himself in a coffin 2 weeks before his assassination. So we know that they are important. So we dream. We dream. Freud, in the late, in 1899, wrote a whole book, 600 pages, on understanding our dream world. That's just our dreams. You know. They say that if you accumulate all the time that you spend dreaming, it amounts to about 6 years during your lifetime. That's a lot of time spent dreaming. But you know, Psychology Today said that the problem with dreams is that they're not really a good guide for reality, that none of them become real. Well, if that were to be the case, I think I would surrender pretty much, because I don't understand why the Creator would give us such a power to have these visions, to have these dreams, to have this wild imagination, if God didn't expect us to use it. But I know our dreams are often condemned. People are afraid of their dreams. Maybe you, early in your life, began to have dreams. Perhaps sometime you would have those terrible nightmares that wake you up, and you would run to mommy and daddy, and you would tell them about your dream, and they would say, oh, don't pay attention to it, forget about it, that there's no such things. Or you were sitting in school and you were daydreaming, and a teacher would come around and call you by name and say, what are you doing, Joe? A bunch of daydreaming? Stop it, cut it out. So dreaming became a problem in our world. And we hesitate to share our dreams. As I shared once before when I was here, that I do Native American spiritual pathways. And when I had some of my visions on my vision quests, I found myself almost terrified to share them with people because they were so unique and so odd in many ways. But if we didn't condemn our dreams, that we somehow embraced them, we somehow invited them into our world, actually encouraged people to dream and share their visions and their reality, their expectations, their dreams, what would happen? You know, the Bible is filled with people who had a very active dream life. You know, we grew up, many of us, singing that old song about climbing Jacob's ladder. That was a dream. It was a wild dream. We know about the person of Daniel. He got himself into a lot of trouble because he could interpret dreams. And Nebuchadnezzar was terrified and very angry at the dreams that Daniel would have. And so he put him in a den of lions because of the dreams. And then he later on had this phenomenal dream that has been interpreted by many people to be a kind of a dream of the end of the world, eschaton.
Moses had his dreams. Abraham had his dreams. Saul, on his road to Damascus, had a vision, and it changed his life, and he became Paul. He was renamed because of that vision. And yes, I believe Jesus himself was a person with a phenomenal imagination. Many of those parables that I read and you read, I believe that those are evidences of a very, very powerful imagination. I don't know whether those things actually happened, the Good Samaritan story, the prodigal son, but they were in his head anyhow. They were something he saw and something that he anticipated and believed in that changed his life and he wanted to share with other people. Jesus had a powerful capacity to communicate what he experienced in the way of understanding and visions and insight. And then we come to Peter. This strange person who had his good days and his bad days following Jesus. Peter was not a Pharisee like Paul, but he had some of the same issues that Paul ran into when he tried to reach out to the Gentiles. You know, there was a whole lot of issues going on at that time about this Christian movement, what was called the Way. It wasn't called Christianity yet, but it was called the Way. And the people who were following in the Way were, in the eyes of many, they were on a slippery slope. If you know much about the history of the Jewish people, you know that they had a wonderful history, very, very rich history, starting with Abraham and being called out of the Ur of the Chaldees, and then into the life of Moses and his experience of the burning bush, his vision, you know, and then great kings like David. And then eventually what happened in about late 900s BC, that kingdom that David had split into two different parts. And it lasted for a while with various kings filling in up until the late 586 BC. And then at that time, it all collapsed. It all fell. And there was no Israel anymore as such. The temple was destroyed, and the people were taken into captivity in Babylon. And there they lasted for a period of time. And eventually they were released and allowed to go back to Jerusalem, to that promised land, and rebuild their temple. And they did that, and they took on that with the intent of trying to reestablish that which was sacred to them, their Jewish way. But you know, after about 300 years, that they entered into a period that we don't know much about sometimes, because it's not in Scripture. It's in that period between Old Testament and New Testament that many Christians have never read much about. If you've ever read the apocryphal books, the books of Maccabees, 1st and 2nd Maccabees, you will run into it. Those books which were in the early King James Version of the Bible when it was translated in the early 1600s, but it was taken out in the late 1700s and removed, and it's no longer in our normal Bible. It's in the Roman Catholic Bible, but not in ours. But in those books, it describes what happened. And what happened in about 200 BC, before the Christian era, was what was called the Seleucids. The great Greek Empire, with Alexander the Great, had come along, and in the wake of that, these kings called the Seleucids took over. And among them was one who was a nightmare for Jews. His name was Antiochus Epiphanes IV. He so hated Judaism, he outlawed everything that was Jewish, their holidays, their festivals. He took over the temple that had been rebuilt when they came back from Babylon. He took that over. He consecrated it to Zeus. He took pigs and offered pigs as sacrifices on the Jewish altar. He made people eat pig pork. And that was against their Jewish law. And that was such treachery, such a problem. And the Jews who were suffering with this saw all this invasion of their sacred text and their sacred way of life. And then in 167 BC came along the Maccabees, Judas Maccabees, and the revolt took place. And that revolt against the Seleucids drove them out of Israel, reestablished their hold on the temple, and Hanukkah was started. That's why Jews celebrate Hanukkah, because they recaptured the temple after the reign of Antiochus Epiphanes. That's their history. And that was all behind those people who were re-establishing Judaism as Jesus comes onto the picture and his disciples and Paul. That's what they remember, how hard it was and how much revolt it took to re-establish their Jewish way of life. So anybody who came along who suggested that there was an alternative, or that they ought to be more inclusive, or they ought to be more tolerant, was suspect. Jesus was one who seemed to understand that those people, those things that are called profane, he deprofaned them. Those people who were considered abominations, he considered to be objects of his love and respect. Now, with all that background, all that history, and I love history and some people don't, but I care for it. So if you have had enough of that, the question is, what does that have to do with us? What does that have to do with us today? Well, I don't think John Lennon and Yoko Ono basically had us in mind when they gave us that wonderful piece. But I think they understood that humanity needs that part of each individual that is that imaginative part, the capacity to dream, the capacity to have visions. And each of you have that in you as a God-given gift to develop, to pay attention to listen, to express, to share. You know, I know we all like to get along with each other. We all like to be in groups where we all think alike and follow the same, but that's not life in many ways. We're going to find people who differ from us. We're going to see each person has their own particular gifts and graces. You know, I think sometimes we in the church struggle with uniformity rather than unity. And unity allows for diversity, allows for differences between us. When I was being trained as a clinical therapist, a counselor, one of the phrases I ran across was a phrase called undifferentiated ego mass. A technical term that psychiatrists, psychologists use to describe people or groups of people who think alike. What they discovered was sometimes there are groups, families, where everybody has the same vocation. You know, they saw clergy. As soon as I learned about this, I thought of this particular family I knew up in Pennsylvania in our conference, where there was grandfather, and all those sons were all preachers. You know, but sometimes you see it among doctor families or lawyer families. You know, think of some of those. And what happens in the undifferentiated ego mass is the individual ego, the individual personality gets lost, because what's important is that all of them's thinking alike. I believe that that's a risk that sometimes we, the church, struggle with. How to have unity and still allow for a lot of diversity. And I think our capacity to have visions, our capacity to dream, allows for that. For you to tell your story, you to tell your story, and each of us to listen to it. I was reading about a church the other day that people tell their stories. And when they tell their individual story at the end of that, someone in the congregation says, this is the word of God for the people of God. They understand that your stories, is God still speaking? God is still speaking through you. And what is unique and different about you? Tomorrow, I will go on my vision quest for 3 days. It's a fast, and I will spend time entering into very, very deep meditation, and almost like a trance. And I do that, and over the years, I've been going to, I started 40, almost 40 years ago, and there was periods of time I couldn't do it because of the kind of work I was doing was so demanding. But since I've retired, I've been able to do it more. But I look forward to it, and I never know what to expect. But I'm never disappointed, but I'm always surprised. I don't know for you, for Christ promised church, but I believe one of the promises that Christ gives us is that each of you have a God-given gift, to dream. Any of you ever been to Epcot?
Yes.
Yes.
Any of you ever ride Soarin'?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Maybe.
All right. You know the story about it? Yeah, Mark Sumner. He had this vision, this dream about this powerful, wonderful ride. But nobody could put it together. Nobody could figure out how to do it. So he got up in his attic with his old director set. And built it on the record with the old director set. It became a reality that millions of people enjoyed. When I learned and I first came to Disney, I'm on my 12th year now. My last year, I learned about Imagineers. Imagineers, I was told, are prohibited saying two particular things when someone shares an idea. They never say, that's a stupid idea. Nor do they ever say, that's too costly, we can't afford it. I think those are good things for churches to embrace. There are no stupid ideas here. And yeah, you may be limited financially, but if you dream and you believe in yourselves and in God's power, and I hear it every time I come here, I hear you praising God for what he is doing, and I see it in you. And I trust and I pray that as you move into a new stage with Pastor Wilkinson, that you will find yourselves dreaming. I'm sure she will have dreams and expectations and imagine things for Christ Promised Church. But I hope you will too. Albert Einstein said, you know, you can all have all the knowledge in the world you want, but there's something greater than knowledge, because knowledge is limited. What's not is the imagination, he said. So dream. Have your vision. Share them with one another. Struggle with one another. And know that the dreams that Pastor Wilkinson will have, the ones that you have, may take many, many years in fulfillment. And be assured that as long as I'm on this earth, I will be praying for Christ Promised Church to hold dreams in your heart and your souls. Oh God, you've called us to be your people. You've not asked us to surrender our minds or our judgment or the things which make us unique. You've invited us to embrace them, just as you could see in the most twisted bodies, the most blind, the most deaf, the most despicable people. You could see hope and promise, and you could see people who were worthy of being loved. So you see it in us. You want us to imagine something that we have never seen before. A place, a congregation, a safe haven for people to come and join and learn together and to love each other. We thank you that this morning we've been blessed as two have entered into that covenant, that promise that they will become partners in this life.
as husband and husband. We ask that you be bless them and each one of us as we enter into the grace, the great gifts that you give to us. And now we ask that you will be with us as we follow through with the meal that you institute.